All right, folks, welcome back. It is day 233. Konnichiwa. Minasan, yokoso. Welcome, welcome. Let's see. Okay, so we started new unit yesterday. Find out how well we remembered our new kanji characters. Yesterday, I think we have largely. They only listed the new kanji characters. All right. Unit 57. Twofold. Weather, more describing as opposed to phenomenon. So. Ooh. Oh, it's so stacked. Hang on. We made it so tall. I can be better. Atsui. Atsui. What are you supposed to touch? Let's rewrite that again. It could be better. Samui. Samui. Oops. Ugh. Yeah, we'll just. Atatakai. Atatakai. Such a large gap. Yeah. Zushi. Am I? Hiroi. Casa. What was it?
Sasu. 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 Sasu.
Susumu, Susumu. Magaru. Kado. Kado. Masuku. Masuku. You can throw in a few directions. Hidari. Miki. That's auxiliary words, conditional words as well. Whoops. Tsuki. E. Kashi. Okay, with demo. Demo. Uru. Oriru. Oriru. And then we'll see if we can pick up any other things. I think there might be two things left out. Okay. Unit 56. What's unit 56? Not common items. Relationships. Son of a bee sting. It's uncommon, right? Yeah. Water, 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 water. Right. Beep. The heck is okay. Okay, straight lines. You may, you may. Dokshin, Dokshin. Kekon. Decon. Decon. Wakareru. She knew. Oops. Nakunaru. Nakunaru. Yobu. Wakai. Akachan. Otona. Umareru.
Otoko. Danse. Onna.男の人、女の人。 男の子、女の子。 方、みんな。大勢。彼女。彼氏。Yeah, I think we're good. All right. I think we got everything, right? Yes.All good. All right. So, 5 lessons. Let's get going.
夜は寒いです。
夜は寒いです。Oh, you know?
夜は寒いです。
We can add like 夜、今夜。夜、今夜。Other time of day. No.朝はありません。Okay. We'll keep track.
寒い。
Sorry, I had to cough.
今日は暖かいですか？今日は暖かいですか？
Okay. 今日は暖かいです。今日、夜。辛い。Okay.
夜。
夜は辛いです。
暗い。
暗い。Oh no, not 辛い。Spicy. Yeah, 暗い。My bad.
です。
The night is spicy. Yeah, 夜は暗いです。暗い。Just throw that in too. So 暗い。暗い。明るい。No, 明るい。暗いand 明るい。 That's pretty good too. There is asa.
Asa.
So,
asa.
Asa and yoru. Asa and yoru is paired up. That's okay.
今夜は雨が降ります.
There's 今夜.
今夜.
今夜 what?
今夜は雨が降ります.
雨が? Wait. Oh, 雨. 雨が. 降ります. 降りました.
今夜は雨が降ります.
降ります.
わ.
Yeah, we wrote 降る. 降る, 降る with 降りる. 今夜, 今夜は雨が降ります.
降ります.
Samui, interesting.
Yoru.
Yoru, yoru wa samui desu.
Wa sam desu.
The reason why I say this is interesting is that English is different. It's cold at night. Yoru wa samui desu. Yoru wa samui desu can be written differently than it is cold at night.
Hiruma wa samuku nai desu.
Oh, hiruma. Yeah, that's another time of day. Yeah, sure. Or like another time. Yeah, like a time aspect.
Hiruma. Hiruma wa samuku nai desu.
Samuku nai desu.
Wa samuku.
Samuku nai desu. So. Right, samui, e adjective to negate samuku nai desu.
Atatakai, samui.
Minasan,
yume, yoru.
Higashi, hana. お金? お金? 夜?
電中? No, just kidding. Sorry. 時計?
時計?
暖かい?
別れません?
寒い? 夜?
若い? 今夜は雪が降ります。今夜は雪が降ります。今夜。でも、今日は。暖かくないです。暖かくないです。でも今日は暖かくないです。ないです。寒いですね。寒いですね。 スプーン色病院今夜銀行風風は強い。今夜は 風が No. Yeah? 風が 強いです. You can add 強い and 弱い. 強い and 弱い is from the previous weather too. So we got a lot of pair-ups.
今夜,
今夜は 風が強いです。
強い。
強いです。
です。
Okay. It's warm today. 今日、今日は暖かいです。ですか？ Is it warm today?
今日は暖かいですか？
今日は暖かいです。
今日は暖かいです。
Alright. Simple. Holy. Alright. Well, we'll do that. We got 30 minutes. Wow, I wasn't expecting someone to complete the friends quest. That's the first time someone else completed the friends quest and not me. Alright.We'll complete this section then. 次
次
次 What's up? We got time. What's up? 次
棚鏡傘次魚
傘
What's
up?
次
傘
傘傘肉
肉
次
窓
おっ
窓窓 Oops. I thought of something else. I thought of I looked down.
次
次
棚次
窓
傘
靴傘
靴
靴
時々
時々
次
次
傘
傘帽子no カバン
カバン
カバンOkay. 狭い狭い
狭い
Oh! Wait. Did I write 狭い, 狭い correctly? No, I don't think so.
狭い
It would look weird if I didn't
狭い狭い
write this top stroke. Yeah, I think we're fine.
狭い
狭い
狭い狭い
狭い
狭い
狭い狭い
Oops, wrong order. Oops.
狭い
Incorrect stroke. I was heading for a die as opposed to my...
あたたかい暖かい
暖かい
暖かい
暖かい暖かい
暖かい
暖かい
暖かい暖かい
暖かい
暖かい
暖かい暖かい
傘傘傘
傘
傘
傘
傘
傘
傘
Casa with four people underneath.
Casa, casa.
Gives a new meaning to mi casa, su casa.
Casa.
Mi casa, mi casa tengo, tengo, cuatro, cuatro hombres? No, I forgot how to say people.
Tsugi.
Tsugi. Whoops, wrong direction.
Tsugi. Tsugi.
Tsugi.
Tsugi.
Tsugi. Tsugi.
Tsugi. Tsugi.
Amoi. Amoi.
Samui.
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 Samui. Samui.
Samui.
So comforting.
Samui.
You know, so comforting.
Samui.
Writing.
Samui.
Therapeutic.
Atsui.
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 My atsui could be better, that's for sure.
Atsui.
It's a little too shifted. My last radical is a little too shifted to the right.
Atsui.
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 And my fourth stroke is a little too long.
Atsui.
Makes it a little too shifted, this one. Is that fourth? Fifth.
Atsui.
Atsui.
Atsui. Atsui.
Did I arrive at the end of the Japanese? No, no, not at the end. At the, like 10 minutes ago. Suzushi. Fashionably Suzushi. Late. No, I'm just kidding. How are you doing, human?
Suzushi.
Suzushi.
What are you up to?
Suzushi. Suzushi.
Suzushi.
So, someone actually finished the friend's quest for me, which is astonishing me. So, I'm just gonna complete the kanji, my backlog of kanji stuff. I liked my prompt. I kind of leaned into my prompt today. Atatakai. Suzushi. You were reviewing some kanji on RTK. What does
Atatakai
RTK stand for again?
Atatakai.
Tsumetai. Oh, you know, we could add tsumetai in. No, they don't really describe weather though.
Tanoshi.
Suzushi.
Atatakai.
Remembering the kanji, the stuff with mnemonics. I see. Remembering the kanji. How is that? How does that work? Like, is that an app?
Atatakai.
Is it a like open source tool or something? I don't remember.
Atata.
Atatakai.
Kai.
Suzushi.
Atatakai.
Atatakai.
Atat. Isogashi. Suzushi. Chiisai. 冷たい。
暖かい。
涼しい。
うん、涼しい。
磯が。
ああ。
磯が。すしい。
No, it's a book, but there's an unofficial associate website. Ooh, that's neat. Ah, man, it's a book, though. I have to start making a list of what I'm going to do next, right? So, I need something that is kind of like... I don't get, like, copyright struck. I'm, like, kind of making a list.涼しい。暖かい。小さい。明るい。新しい。うん。新しい。Oh. That's awkward.
暖か。
You make stories, images in your head that involve the meaning and all the components of kanji are trying to remember. TBH, Duolingo is probably teaching you the kanji just fine. Yeah, yeah, but I like, I enjoy hearing other people's like mnemonics. It inspires me for like drawing and whatnot. And also,if I don't come up with a mnemonic, right, I can only force myself to come up with as many mnemonics as possible. But it's kind of nice to engage in other people's mnemonics, too. I like sharing, right? Sharing is caring. The anecdotes that I come up with when I try to connect with people largely comes from something outside myself. I share lots of other people's stories.I don't have a lot of relatable personality and stories of my own. Whenever I'm sharing, my stories tend to stick out because it's atypical, as opposed to typical. So it's kind of fun to think about what are other mnemonics that other places would use. The downside is, well,It defeats the sharing part if I can't share it.
新しい。
That's my favorite part, making commentary on other people's like creative stuff. I'm the commentary guy.
忙しい。
暖かい。
涼しい。
冷たい。
You associated...that with a modest proposal and you haven't forgotten the kanji sense? Ooh, is that for like modesty? How is it associated? I'm not clear with that term yet. Yeah, I'm not familiar with this in Japanese. It's got a lot of uses in Chinese already. A modest proposal, that's cute. A model proposal is a satirical essay that advocated for eating babies. Yeah, I know what a modest proposal is, but I have no idea what that character is. Yeah, a modest proposal is a common essay for literature or like education literature.It's actually a poster child for satirical writing. It's a really common American English example of satire. Or used for satire. Oh...To raise or bring up. Oh, a modest proposal. Oh, I see. What do you think of a modest proposal? You are actually one of the first people that brought it up before I did. I brought it up like two or three times before. However, most, let's just say most kids these days, when they go through English class, they don't remember those essays very often. I quite like Amada's proposal. It's not topical anymore, but it was topical when there wasn't like a downward trajectory of human population due to like resources and climate change. But now, you think it's hilarious? You like how it plays it straight? Yeah. Yeah. It was certainly ahead of its time. That's for sure. Right? It's certainly ahead of its time. Have you seen the movie Okja? Okja, it's a Korean movie. It was funded by Netflix. Okja. Or did you see Cloud Atlas? The movie Cloud Atlas. And specifically, the Neo Tokyo branch of Cloud Atlas. There's a modest proposal reference in both of them. Although the other one, Okja, is closer to more like what if animals are highly intelligent and engineered. You haven't seen too many Korean movies? Yeah, Okja was a Western production, but it was in Korean. It's the theme is about consuming intelligent life form, right? So Okja took the more literal approach, and then Cloud Atlas is a pan time period, really excessively long indie, extremely expensive indie film, featuring a lot of great talents. And it's like a universe extending one, and one of the threads of fate in it deals with something that plays on Amada's proposal, at least in my opinion. It reminded me of Amada's proposal. Pretty neat. It kind of pulled like a Black Mirror thing.
Kyoto.
Kyoto. Where are we going with Kyoto? Oh, Suzushi. Yeah. That's how I remembered it, by the way. Duolingo calls me out all the time. Yesterday's new vocabulary was Suzushi. And I stopped like routinely saying out loud what I used to associate, because I expect that Duolingo is going to do it. Yeah, Suzushi and Kyoto. Kyoto is how I remember Suzushi. Temporarily.
Tokyo.
And you can use Tokyo as well if you wanted.
Tokyo.
Suzushi.
Suzushi.
Okay.
Tokyo.
Yoji.
Isogashi. 7000.
Suzushi.
Suzushi.
Tokyo.
Tokyo. Oops.
Irigucci. Suzushi.
Jumai.
Kyoto.
Tanoshi.
Tokyo.
Kyoto.
Kyoto.
8歳.
8歳.
Suzushi.
Suzushi.
新しい
時間。
涼しい。
涼？うん。え？
わ。
お。We're not gonna talk about that. I clicked on the first thing. Semi.
狭い。
Sometimes I do that. I don't want to talk about it.
狭い。
狭い。
It reminds me of playing a video game and you're like a DPS player see something, shoot something. Click on the first thing you see. Not that I'm a DPS player, but it kind of reminds me of that. Shoot, shoot first, ask later. Choose first, ask later. Okay. Kasa.
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 You've been using the wrong stroke order for the radical. The hand radical? Oh. Kasa. Interesting. This hand radical? Or do you mean... Yeah, this hand radical? Oh, and Neko. Oh, this radical. Oh. Probably this one, right? Because it kind of looks like... It does kind of look like hand.
Kasa.
Kasa. I totally get those too. Kasa. Every once in a while.
Kasa.
It's like, oh, yeah, that's okay. It's a quick fix.
Kasa.
You know, it's a quick fix. Especially when someone is like writing very often. It's a quick fix. It's hard to forget if you do a lot of writing. You know, the one change, hard to forget.
次.
Yeah. 次.
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 It's one of those things, like for example, I don't know if you do this mentally, or are aware how this impacts you. When everything is new, things get confusing, right? With practice, though, it creates a consistency that allows you to contrast between what is out of place. So even when all the concepts are novel, if you practice those concepts, whenever a mistake comes up, it becomes more like vivid. So even if you had like 1,000 kanji that you're working on, right? Provided you have built up a foundation of consistency, like say an 80% ratio in which you practice, right? That even a higher consistency creates something that quote-unquote is hard to remember, maybe, or could potentially be confusing, that consistency ends up making the thing that sticks out less confusing. So oftentimes when I think of like stroke order, when people say, oh, what if you build a bad habit, then it would be hard to break. Like, well, not necessarily. It's hard to break if you had a bad habit that's not reinforced by practicing good habits, in my opinion. So for writing, for example, if you do just enough writing to learn things, then you haven't entered practice mode, which builds consistency but not learning. And that built consistency, well, how does output, a lot of people underplay output, which I kind of understand that. However, with sufficient output, sometimes that can alleviate and support learning. So that's the whole idea, like good foundations, right? If something's built on a quote unquote good foundation, more like I think the word I would probably use is a consistent foundation, because the foundation could be erroneous. That's perfectly fine, like it's still technically consistent. So a consistent foundation, whichever it may be, creates contrast for any incoming information. And that's kind of how I approach. That's like my summary of one of the major tenets, at least in my opinion, the major tenets that I reinforce when it comes to things like this, or science, like learning science. The more consistent your foundation is, whether it's erroneous or not, later down the road when you're making a mistake, because of your grand consistency, it's quite very quote unquote easier to pick out when you're going to, when that mistake may occur again, and self-correct, and it like gets nailed down really hard. Think of it, in my opinion, like a board, right? You have lots of nails on the board. You could have lots of nails popping up, and there are individual mistakes. The board itself still exists, but if there are many nails up, then you don't know which nail is concordant with the mistake you're making. However, if most of the nails are down and it's just one nail you discovered, easily hammered down. It's kind of one of those things. That's not the greatest analogy, but that's kind of what I'm trying to illustrate. That this is one of the approaches. It doesn't have to be. Others do the blasting thing, that's fine too. Or people want to do like get it right the first time so you don't have to relearn approach. I mean, that's fair if you can pull it off. I don't. There's also like later on when you have a board, right? Sometimes the nail, after using it for so long, some of the nail can pop back up. However, because you have a consistency, these errors that drift and stuff can get hammered down pretty quickly again. So consistency and foundation. It's really fantastic. And consistency and foundation, in my opinion, is nearly contributed more than 50% by output, in my opinion, not input. The effect that I'm talking about is purely on how output interacts with input, as opposed to like taking in more and more input. Well, if you take more and more input, it's difficult to know if you have a nail sticking out or a gap in your knowledge, because when you're doing input, you're assuring yourself that everything is okay. You're not outputting anything to know if there's anything that is missing, right? So the whole like input only thing, I get it. In my opinion though, the truth is you're outputting something in order to know you're going in the right direction. It doesn't have to be a literal output. You're not like literally writing or literally speaking, but you're recalling. Recalling is understated. Rarely do I see when people say, oh, all input all the time. No, you make decisions based on your recall. Unless you're not actively participating in your input, then you're not actively recalling. So what happens when it looks like you don't actively recall in your head while doing input? Immersion baby. Like myself. I don't know how to read Mandarin, even though I'm staring at Mandarin most of the time of my life. Really early on, I didn't get it, right? Because I'm not recalling anything that I saw. So I think the whole like all input all the time kind of thing is an incredibly big misleading generalization. And I appreciate people who are consistently finding ways to balance between using output as a read for their input. I think it involves a general learning process and a growth skill that is absent a lot of times, or underdeveloped in the age of internet information. If someone tells you what the right thing is and you know that they're right, then you have no basis for evaluating your own input and output. Like, you don't need to do it. If someone always tells you the right thing, you don't ever have to self-check yourself, right? And because of that non-practice, the lack of output, ironically, like paradoxically or inception-wise, right? you don't practice self-evaluation. There's no output. And language learning might work for someone who already understands that. It, in my opinion, it doesn't necessarily work ideally if it's someone who doesn't even have output monitoring skills. So oftentimes when people are talking about methods for secondary language acquisition, they're also insisting that that person understands how to evaluate themselves. Because one of the tenets of a lot of the methods is an accurate measure of one's own competence in order to understand how to challenge oneself, right? You go to the gym, how much weight do you weigh? Like, are you gonna lift? Well, if you don't know anything, you start somewhere and then you build from there. You hope that that person develops self-correcting skills through output which then feed back to their input. However, if that never happens, then you might have someone who ends up regularly injuring themselves, plateauing or stagnating, and generally overall probably pushed to quit. That's a tough reality.
Tsugi.
I like to think that it's hard to get through childhood, right? It's hard to get through childhood not being able to do any of that. So we're not saying that people have no form of self-evaluation. I like to encourage people though. Like, as a not a like a negative thing. It's like, oh, you're glad you caught it kind of thing. At least that's what I'm trying to, in a long story short, it's glad that you're able to catch it, right? Imagine doing that and trusting the process for like 5 years. Go to Japan, no, everyone's polite, they don't tell you anything about that because they're being polite, and then realizing one day, like 30 years down the line or something. It could be a funny story. I don't know. Yeah. If you get used to correcting yourself because you like to output with incomplete knowledge, right? You like to learn and output at the same time, then it usually becomes a fun activity as opposed to a negative activity. I like solving problems and mistakes that I make. It's something that is, I dare say, I might rub people the wrong way. Like, there's a difference between learning from your mistakes and having the capacity to learn from your mistakes. So what I mean is, sometimes people say, oh, let me make my mistakes because that is a great way to learn. It's a great way to learn if you're able to learn from your mistakes, able to see it, use it, and normalize it, right? And also, it's very important that you can build consistency in order to inform your mistakes. Otherwise, you enter, in my opinion, you enter that situation where some people have insecurities about, which is to develop a bad habit. That habit where, oh, what happens if you make the mistake so often you can't correct it anymore? Well, generally, in my opinion, that comes from someone who rarely wants to make mistakes or have made mistakes and learned and used that as a way to rectify the mistake. So someone who fears making a mistake is someone who doesn't normalize the idea that learning involves mistakes. So for those people, they can perfectly be fine. They can, you know, do things perfectly to make them satisfied. However, whenever they make a mistake, it's like the world ended. Or like, it's like a shock to their pride, or it's uncomfortable, it's a negative feedback. When I make a mistake, easily rectified. It's so common, it's regular. The fun, it's part, it's actually probably one of the more fun aspects of learning. If I make a mistake, How do I solve it? Like, how do I come up with a new way to not make that mistake again? Someone asked me earlier today, why draw once a month instead of once a week for the entire year? And my thought was, well, I draw consistent enough in order for me to use that as a point of reference for everything else. So output practice is not, I'm not saying you have to output your entire life. You output sufficiently enough to understand and appreciate where you are. And that competence is what you build on. That competence and consistency is what you build on. Output practice is what has helped you the most when it comes to speaking, at least, and pronunciation. Fair enough. Me too. Like, and what I mean is pronunciation, and not in the same pronunciation of sufficient pronunciation, like wanting to say Japanese words and all that. Obviously, if you're doing the whole like perfect pitch accent, that kind of thing, that's fair too. That takes away from the whole idea of outputting in general, because I do feel when someone is overtly concerned about certain things that is part of the learning process, you end up not speaking at all or doing any output practice, which I feel that a ton of people who ask me, oh, can you converse yet? I'm like, what do you mean, can I converse yet? I talk about Japanese all the time. It's like, well, only in Japanese. It's like, well, I can't express everything in Japanese right now, so I wouldn't speak all in Japanese. And that to me is the difference in the trivialities of someone who only speaks when they're competent enough to express everything, because they don't practice, they don't have output practice at all in mind, to someone who outputs regardless of their competence because they're using it as a feedback for their input. My pronunciation informs me things. My struggles and whatnot informs me things. And I could try to do both as much as I can, right? Not for everyone. Some people don't have time. Some people don't have patience. Fair enough. You know, I'm offering an alternative. I see mistakes as learning opportunities. It's a very telling, the mistakes that I make, and it allows me to evaluate for future. Not the same as making the mistake and not learning from it. I think lots of people like the idea of learning from their mistakes. However, I beg to differ that they learned from the mistakes. When one learns from the mistakes, they approach it to correct the mistake, right? To actively solve the mistake. When you say, oh, I'll just study harder next time, or oh, I will put in even more practice of the same way that I've done, and then they go on to make that mistake again. That is not output practice. That is informing, problem solving. It's let's brute force it. Old hat, in my opinion. So if you can't remember something, go make a new mnemonic. If you can't remember something, explain why you can't this time, and then explain why to yourself you can't the next time. I like to hope that it's going to be a different answer. You can still make the same mistake, but not in the same way. And understanding how you make mistakes in different ways is growth. It's amazing growth. You know, for many occasions. So I often am a person who likes to emphasize output practice when you have time. I think a lot of times I need to put that asterisk, because people skip output practice due to efficiency argument. And I totally concede that. it does lower your input efficiency. When whatever time you, whatever else you do, lowers input efficiency. So you have to ask yourself, what quality of life do you have if you're input only, right? I certainly wouldn't get the same adventure and tangential, like, I prefer adulterating my input efficiency with output. Largely because of the whole consistency thing. You don't know if you're consistently doing something if you haven't output anything. It's one of the biggest deep cuts is that recall is not consistent for a majority of people. I would even argue, okay, not greater than 50%. That's kind of a tall order. I'm going to say it's more like, if I wanted to make a conservative estimate, I think 30%. Sorry, the other way. Less than 30%, but that's a very significant of language learners do not participate in active recall that is consistent. In active recall in a manner that is consistent, growing in complexity, or growing in efficiency, complexity, and utility. So if you're sticking and you're saying your recall is, you start off in language learning, your recall is, oh, I remember what the card looks like. Oh, okay, this word sounds like this. That's a great start. That creates consistency with a foundation. Now, how do you recall better? I'm not saying overnight. These things take years or months, you know, at least months. I think over the course of 7 months for me, I've introduced 3 new habits from my start. When I started, it's exactly what Duolingo provides or prescribes. That's how it starts. And then slowly test, refine your way of active recall. I think active recall is the lowest. It's the most, I'm not going to use lowest, and I don't use like the, I think it's the likely intuitive and most commonly used, perhaps like largely used step for output practice. Like this is output practice right here. You are taking an input and you are practicing to build a consistent output association. This output, for a lot of people, at least especially Japanese, I would say, is eyes only. So how do you improve your recall? Speak. Write, draw, construct. You know, and all of these can be subdivided into different components until it becomes like breathing and speaking English or speaking your native language. Your active recall is going to remain a compartmentalized active recall. And I, in my opinion, with all this said, is easier now understanding all these factors. That's how I measure fluency. In my opinion, this is how I can tell someone at some point my fluency is going up. It's not a 0 and a 1, like one day I'm going to be fluent and one day I'm not. It's the extent of how active recall is being developed. So if you're not developing progressively to speak, to write, it makes sense, right? Like, I'm not making like this is a repackaging of things. When you engage in the most activities possible while you're doing recall, and it becomes a daily activity, doesn't that look like fluency, right? You write with because you write because you want to write. You speak because you want to speak. So as these little different areas of recall gets bolstered over time because you're doing output practice, your fluency goes up. Fluency is not a zero and one. I would say my fluency is about 40% right now. I take almost half of the time, I have no problems thinking and writing something in Japanese. Right? So, not how much you know, right? Not how much input you know. How comfortable you are in retrieving what you have. You personally have a very hard time learning new words that have kanji you can't write. Me too, actually. I would have to say it's a double edge, right? So there are patterns and habits that you develop. So now you know what you want to do, right? So you have like an element of what's under practice and whatnot. It is possible to like train, right? You can practice forcing yourself not to write something and then develop a new recall for it. That is going to deviate away from the power of writing. So that kind of thing. It is possible. And I try to do it, I mix it up every once in a while. One day I like to write, one day I like to speak, one day I like to construct. Like construct is like a combination of these two. So oftentimes, if there was something as a meta level of writing and speaking, is to construct, right? So it is possible to like kind of tailor and focus on them. It's not necessary. I don't think it's necessary. Whatever helps sufficiently, sustainable to promote recall actively is probably your key for pretty much anything, honestly. Like anything knowledge-based. Funnily enough, output versus input methods is a major debate in the science of language learning right now. It is, yeah. That I gathered that, at least that, like topically, without understanding too much of, like, I don't know, you know, like I didn't read their thesis and all the thesis and all the, I read talking points on most of them, and I imagine output and input. I don't think necessarily, not even in the field of language learning, like pedagogics, right? Pedagogics, like education, I can't even spell it, pedagogics. Education, foundations of education is often dealing with this question since ever. And I'm very, very much into it. I like it. I like the discussions of it. Not to necessarily promote a gold standard, more so to acquire as many methods, output input methods, in order to adjust to learning situations. Maybe there's going to be something that I don't need to write to learn things. For now though, at least for language learning, writing is definitely a must. Hearing myself speak is very helpful too. When I was younger, to read like grammar stuff, like in English and stuff, the first thing I discovered for myself is reading out loud. And that came much, much later. Like when I was 17 or 18. Before then, it wasn't about reading out loud, which I do now, right? I'm obviously reading these things out loud. Self-dialogue. Self-dialogue involves a construction process with hearing. I don't write self-dialogue to myself too much anymore. That's in the form of journaling. However, I worked in science, right? So journaling is a thing, right? That's called a lab notebook. So, like note-taking, lab notebook. So you can reiterate on yourself on having construction. So you can force yourself to construct on a daily basis. And construction can integrate writing and speaking whenever you want. So that's one of the things where if you feel like you're a little too dependent, if you feel like it's negative, like you feel like it's, you're strongly dependent on one form of output, construction can kind of like balance that out. Sometimes when you construct, oftentimes it ends up tackling speech and writing as a way of encoding information. So like, for example, here's one. I used to record, like, I write notes in my lab notebook. If I didn't write in my lab notebook, I would forget the details quicker. So, before, when I'm writing notes, I also read notes, my lab notebook, to see if it's, like, sounds good or whatnot, and I do both. So, I less and less, my frequency in looking at my lab notebook become less and less. And then in the future, as I was getting like further and further away from my lab, doing lab notebook, I output practice in order to encode. And this became a plan B. So the lab specific book stuff becomes a plan B. So what happens when plan B happens is that my lab notebook then became shorthand. Shorthand in order to compress information. So now a lot of the stuff ends up being up here, and all the shorthand is to compress specific details. So then you can negotiate what is foundational or interpretive to the details of the lab notebook. So then my lab notebook became a whole list. It becomes a cookbook instead, where the cookbook doesn't have necessarily the implicit instructions. It's shorthand instructions with all the nitty-gritty details, which I don't spend time, because I don't want to disproportionately spend a time looking at numbers that may not contextually be efficient in interpreting. Like, you're not interpreting a number. Like, for example, oh, today I use 1.21 grams instead of 1.203 grams. I can check what the variation is and then use significant figures to say I used approximately 1.2 grams, right? So that kind of thing. And I do that already with my mnemonics. I do that with my mnemonics for language. So the mnemonics then get shorthanded over and over again because they're becoming more elaborate. So as my mnemonics get bigger and bigger, right, they will start encompassing, instead of units, we're thinking about sections in Duolingo speak. And then sections could be then become games. Games could become novels. And what happens then is I have to develop more and more shorthand and an ability to become more and more efficient in my recall. So I'm building up my recall as I'm going. And the foundation really came from, well, how do you keep a good lab notebook? Now I start thinking all the way back to when even when I was younger, it's like, what's the point of keeping a lab notebook if you remember all the information anyways, right? It teaches a different skill, at least in my opinion. So if I was going to have to write a lab notebook anyways, I'd at least develop more skills. And, you know, I'm getting older. It's kind of hard to not write things down. So you get these adults who go through relying solely on their their tried and true method of recall, and discover much, much later in adulthood the output and input method question. In my opinion, it's not output versus input method. It's both. It's output and input methods. If you have time and the luxury, it's output and input methods. So it's a more holistic approach. And you refine your output and input methods that best suits your sustainability. A fight for efficiency and exclusivity is, in my opinion, so anti-objective. Is so weird. Like, what I mean is, when you're evaluating, like, you do an experiment, you create a methodology, and your methodology only addresses one theory as opposed to looking at all the intersecting theories and methods, that's weird. So if there's a scholarly, like, proponent out there who's making an incredibly bold claim, I hope that they're right or something like that, because in my opinion, it is so bold for any intellectual individual, especially in the sciences or in the act of discovering things and, like, education and whatnot, to say something like, oh, it's output versus input. It's how much output, how much input, what is the combination that results in a desirable, consistent effect that passes an arbitrary threshold that they desire. Maybe it's 95% confidence interval, etc. It's rarely ever 0 or 1. Is how can I negotiate all of these things and come out? I think it's incredibly foolish and unlikely to see a very well-educated colleague who suggests, oh, it's all or none. It's crazy to even think that. Some of the most established, like, dogma of, like, scientific objective evaluation still does not caress an all or none thing. It's rarely ever all or none. So the whole, like, apples versus oranges comparison is kind of weird to me. And it's very prevalent online, right? Online, that's kind of how debates go. It's not a control experiment saying, like what is a great methodology for testing input and output efficiency? Have one input method, add an output method, and subtract the output method. You got to know what the interactions between output and input is right now, right? Output versus input, that's kind of weird, because then you'll only be testing input methods against output method. Like, I know that's not what they're probably doing. They're probably saying which one's more efficient, that kind of thing. However, if their experiments are viewed that way, then they're comparing apples and oranges. You're comparing output methods with input methods, as opposed to holding outputs consistent plus or minus input, holding input consistent plus or minus output, right? There's got to be some relatives and whatnot. So hopefully that's what they're doing. I don't really know how they measure that stuff. It's weird. Español? Un poco español. Not the greatest. Hablo inglés? Hablas inglés? Hello there, though. Okay. Just Spanish? Solamente español? I only have like a little bit. A little bit, Pablo. Just a little bit. You can use Japanese if you're learning Japanese. We'll try with Japanese. Hablas japonés. Maybe. Semai.
Semai. Atsui.
Atsui.
Semai. Okay.
Semai. Kitanai. Yasui. Atsui.
Hayai.
Atsui. Semai.
Atsui. Atsui.
Okay.
Semai.
Aoi.
Aoi. Atsui. Takai. Wakai.
Wakai.
Semai.
Semai.
Sei.
Yowai.
Yowai.
Ikui.
Shikui. Semai. Atsui. Kuro.
Atsui.
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 Shiroi.
Shiroi.
Semai.
Semai.
Aoi.
Aoi. Kitanai. Hmm. Oh. That was short-lived when it comes to Spanish, I suppose. Maybe in the future. Maybe in the future I'll circumvent the whole Spanish thing.
Sashimashita.
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 Kasa o sashite ii desu ka?
Kasa. Kasa o sashite.
Sashite.
Ii desu ka?
Ii desu ka?
Sashimasen.
Sashimasen.
Atataku. Sashi.
Shikashi, kyou wa atatakaku nai desu.
Shikashi. Kyou wa atatakai. Atatakaku nai desu.
Atatakaku.
Atatakaku nai desu.
Shikashi, kyou wa atatakaku nai desu.
Kasa.
Kasa.
Demo, kyou wa atsui desu.
Demo, kyou wa atsui desu.
Demo, kyou wa
atsui desu.
Atsui desu.
Sashimasen.
Sashimasen.
Yes. Shikashi. Shikashi, kyou wa atatakaku nai desu. Atatakaku. Atatakaku nai desu. Shikashi.
Shikashi. Wa.
Oops.
Wa. Kyou wa. Atatakaku nai desu.
Kasa
o sashimasen deshita.
Kasa o sashimasen deshita.
Kasa
o sashimasen deshita.
Sashi mase deshita.
Okay. Kasa o
さしてください。傘を
さしてください。
きた
スープ、
誕生日、
傘、
夜。 Where are you at? But, how's it going at your end, human, by the way, in terms of your Japanese stuff? Are you able, like, have you been finding fun ways to, like, go about your regular day, being able to add particular output practice here and there, like finding clever and new ways of making it a regular part of your daily routine, human? Like what have you been doing lately as a recent I forgot to make a disclaimer. Sometimes, though, overcomplicating things is a problem. It is a double edge. I understand. Having too much output practice is most definitely something that, you know, too much of most things is definitely can foster complacency as well. I think one of the downsides of SRS is potentially too much output practice when people are not changing up the way they output. They're not refining their output. So that can very well be a problem too. So, you know, both input and output methods are refinement and consistent engagement concerns. You're reading whole volumes of manga, and I sometimes find a native speaker to speak to. Oh, well, yeah, well, there you go. Although I'm a bit slow when it comes to speaking. Nah, that sounds fantastic. Why even study anymore? No, I'm kidding. Do you plan on... So I imagine then you basically read manga as a lifestyle hobby, right? And that's already sustainable, so it sounds like you're pretty much there. Do you ever, are you planning to aim for more? Like, what are you gonna go beyond whole volumes of manga? Do you ever wanna, like, write a manga, maybe? Or, I imagine you already, like, talk about the manga to your native speakers. You read manga because I can't read full novels in Japanese yet. Oh, novels. Okay. That's kind of nice to have, like, something a little bit far down the road. Excellent. Yeah. Yeah, hands down. Yeah. You've always been a better writer than an artist. Oh, well, human being. You could collaborate with an artist. What was a dynamic duo that I can think of? I think one dynamic duo that I can think of is the people who did Bakuman. I think it's a two-party effort. One is the writer and one is the... It's kind of autobiographical, actually. In a way, because the show is also... about a writer and an artist. I only watched 3 seasons. I'm not sure if that kept going, but Bakuman was a Osamu Dasai. The novelist? Yeah, you mentioned that. Wait, are you the one that mentioned the thing and then... Yes, we already had this conversation, didn't we? Yeah, you mentioned this guy before.
Yeah. Well, hopefully you get an opportunity to read a novel by that person.
今日は暑いですね。
今日は暑いですね。I want to engage, like one of the things that I would love to do is have enough competence to engage in multilingual stuff. So I think overall, when I reach that state, I'm probably gonna vibe the rest of it for the rest of my life. The multilingual state. that involves like, hey, yo, this video game's in English, Japanese, and Chinese. I can enjoy it three times over with three different contexts. I think that's sufficient for me. And not in like a comprehensible, like a comprehensive way. Largely to engage. It triples my exposure to something. I do it for the perspective as opposed to, so like I don't necessarily think reading a translation of something is lesser than reading the source in its own. However, I would love to have a luxury of doing both, or to some extent more than one. Much like it's not about output versus input, but it's output and input. I'm a greedy person when it comes to intellectual enrichment. I'll take as much as I'm offered, as opposed to expend the least and getting the biggest bang for my buck kind of thing. I think any is good for something voluntary. 今日は暑いですね。
暖かい傘
差します。
寒い
差しました。しかし今日は寒いです。Yes.
しかし。
しかし今日は寒いです。
です。
暑いですね。暑い。
です。です。ですね。
I clearly missed. 可以。No, I'm just kidding. 傘を差して、差して。Can you put up my umbrella? Oh. Kasa o sashite ii desu ka?
Kasa o
sashite
ii ka?
Alright.
Susumimasen.
Susumimasen.
Kaze wa suzushii desu ka?
Okay.
風は涼しいですか？風は
涼しいです
か？涼ですか？
狭い。
I don't want to talk about it. 進みません。進みません。
進みません。進みます。進み
ます。狭い。
狭い。
この道は狭いです。
この道は
狭いです。
狭いです。
Oh, I forgot about こっちゃ、そっちゃ、あっちゃ、and どっちゃ。Which are going to go over. That's something I forgot.
次。
Have you tried the phone version of Duo? I have tried the phone version of Duo. And it's superior. its feature set is superior. And what I mean by superior is, objectively speaking, it basically have features that the desktop version does not have. Like, full stop, nothing is different outside of additional features, which is kind of nice. The first time I used mobile was when I went to Otakon about a month ago. So I used the mobile then, and then a little bit sparingly afterwards to get like stuff, but almost exclusively on desktop. I use the mobile to look at features that are available on mobile. Like I used it on my own time to look at what is the difference. So I used it then. I like their rotating like events. There are quite a lot of things that the desktop is sufficient though. Like the material, the content itself does not change. How you engage with the content though. Yes. I think Duolingo has quite a lot. Like for example, the Chinese course. I'm not sure if the Japanese, my phone version does not have it. I have an Android, by the way. Also, by the way, Duo is they prioritize iPhone rollouts before Android. One of the features, I think it's iPhone only at the moment, is speech recognition for Japanese. However, the Chinese one has speech recognition. The desktop version has neither. Neither has speech recognition. To me, that's cool. It's another feature set to correct your sub and whatnot, or like output or seeing how far you can push it. However, it doesn't change what I'm doing. So there are lots of feature sets to introduce more output practice or output feedback. However, I don't necessarily think I need to use the mobile version. If they roll it out to the desktop version, that's fantastic. It doesn't necessarily dramatically change how I process my own. So less is, you know, it's kind of one of those things, like I understand what's missing. So I'll do then the best I can, right? It is super neat though. The Japanese version actually has a rollout for voice recognition. I specifically think it's an iPhone thing though. So if you have an iPhone, you can see how sensitive it is. The Chinese course, I like speaking to the Chinese course. So when I had like super and stuff, I almost exclusively just use the mic because it's a lot of fun. Not that it changes anything, because I still output regardless. And I actually say the things that I already say. And I didn't encounter a problem. Except on the Chinese side of things. It's actually faster to hit the mic and... It's slower because it takes the mic, the voice recognition system, some time to register your answers. It takes less... reading. So whenever I need to close my eyes because my eyes are bleeding out of my head because I've had a long day, I'll use to speak. That's so convenient. And then when you don't want to speak and you don't want to listen, for example, you can turn that off too and then only rely on your eyes. If you don't want to speak, you can, yeah, it's nice. Actually, it's quite lovely. Now, will I say the average user be able to perform enough consistent output with all those feature sets? Probably not. They try to splice it in between each lesson. So lessons have like a combination of speech, etc., and even writing. Sometimes construction is missing, so that might be in the future. I know that though the maxed version, Duolingo Max, already has construction. So will it ever be rolled down? I don't know. The subscription is $12 a month. I feel for web hosting the AI, right? For the role playing and construction, $12 a month, that's pretty reasonable. If they disclose, I think it can be reasonable disclosing, maybe understanding that their max subscribers are like a percentage of the users of some sort.
pretty neat. Overall, I think Duo does have a feature set that covers a lot of output practice, like a substantial amount of output practice, especially with the almost full rollout of the role-playing instruction. Whether it's perfect is up to individuals who want to go around and be toxic to everyone else. Tools are not to be, in my opinion, cautiously optimistic to be idolized. Not like idealized. Sorry, not idolized. Idealized. However, with that said, I will probably end up using some version of OpenAI's ChatGPT to simulate the a very similar response in the future. I would totally subscribe maybe 1 month to Duel Max in the future to see what it's like, you know, because they already give ability to test out what Super is like, so I kind of know. And then I logged into my mobile version to test all the Super features on the mobile. Those are the two instances that I've used the Duolingo version. It's quite nice, even with the Super thing. Provided you're using a target language that has those feature sets, right? That is the big, big deal. You gotta know what your target language is. I don't think Duolingo ever beat around the bush about saying like which their feature sets. It can be a little dubious, I suppose. A lot of people say like if you advertise something, be more specific about it. However, they're not lying about anything. Like the idea when someone says, oh, I got duped to thinking Duolingo is great, but I wanted to learn insert some rare language that they recently added, and they're like, it's garbage. I'm like, well, yeah, well, development cycle. They roll out on a rolling basis. So, I don't know. And then someone would then retort and say an apples and oranges comparison. Like, oh, well, this course has been introduced 8 years ago, and this course has introduced 3 years ago, and this course has more updates and a more refined course than the one that is older. Yeah, because Duolingo's rollouts are interest-based. So, if you're willing to pay and convince lots and lots of people to pay to escalate interest-based design like Duolingo, then hopefully you're a millionaire to push for that, right? So kind of expect it, right? It's neat. I don't know if you've used the mobile version or not, human being, like got a idea of what the mobile version is like.
Sugi.
The features can make or break, in my opinion. Nah, not really break. It can make learners complacent, though. I think overall, if your goal is to be self-sufficient, like if your goal is to have this lofty idea of fluency, right? The lofty idea of being self-reliant, the greater the tool, the higher chance you are going to do less, and you're going to do more, or you're going to use it longer in order to achieve a satisfying result. A tool that does less is more likely going to impart and obligate one to do more. The question is, how much more can you handle? And most of the time, when it comes to Duolingo, I think the vast majority of people who quote unquote take language seriously, maybe over 60%. No, that's too much. Like maybe over 30 to 40% of users would eventually find out they can handle more. So they go and use tools that actually does less what does like does Aki do more or less than what Duo does? Well, it's not necessarily in the eye of the beholder. When something is harder, if someone says, oh yeah, this is harder because I get challenged with more volume and stuff, that doesn't necessarily mean they're doing more for you. They're making you learn more, as in there's more for you to do. So the tool actually does less for you, which makes you wonder if there's a tool that constantly tells you that you're saying something correct, are you going to be able to know when you're saying things incorrectly over time? One would like to say, if you always know the correct thing, you wouldn't have to worry about saying something incorrect. Like, well, that is true. You can definitely go and live your rest of life knowing that you don't ever need the skills to understand that when you make a mistake, what do? That's the world we live in my opinion. Tools are made for perfect things. So when someone uses a tool, they expect it to be perfect because you yourself want to be perfect. You don't want to deal with solving problems. Do it right the first time. You don't have to do it ever again, right? Learn it right the first time. And largely that does work for the most part, until human error comes in. And then human error knocks at the door sufficiently enough to get someone really, really triggered because they believe that they're always 99.9% correct. That sucks. I don't think, I can't even sympathize with that. Like, my life up to this point cannot sympathize with that. It's so hard for me to say you have my sympathies for being triggered by understanding that learning something involves making errors, right? And not seeing it as a negative thing. When you make an error while learning, it means it's an opportunity to learn. If you don't make any errors, funny enough, if you're consistently not making errors at all, there is a high chance you're actually learning very little. It's a reality. Like, someone who is learning a lot and making errors is more likely to incline to improve substantially than someone who's afraid of making errors and selectively designed to not make any errors. That's not to say that person isn't learning. They're learning, likely to learn less, right? It's about how much the person can handle. So I don't mind Duolingo, although pushing my error rate up is okay too, right? The Duolingo's approach is like 95% correct rate. So I would say at least 90 to 95% accuracy. So my thought is, what happens if Duo pushes that envelope down to like 80%? Does that make like a large majority of users quit? It can happen. There's a reason why FromSoft games are so good by a select group, because they decided to cater to that group. And regardless of those ridiculous numbers that you have, like, you know, like they sold 5 million copies and stuff, it is easily, in my opinion, blasted by something that has an even higher paid contribution and cadence to the casual. It's to the point where Elden Ring leaned back on more casual designs in order to draw in a bigger crowd. Human condition. All the designs push the player to do less. So increasing aid and increasing convenience lowers the input necessary, which makes it more casual and ultimately contributes to a larger audience. And Duo, what the number tells you is that Duo is casual forward. So no, I don't agree with people talking about like
oh, it's automatically assumed if it's casual forward, it only goes over the basics, or is only capable of doing basic things and whatnot. That happens a lot, right? So I'm like contradicting myself, like I'm creating a counter argument to my own self, my own perceptions, right? My own like line of thinking right now, because I don't want to make it sound like it's one way or the highway. Just do really, really hard things. I have time to do things fun, entertaining, and highly comprehensible versus not highly comprehensible, right? There are time and place for them. The idea is what Duo has to offer, I'll try my best to make it work. So I do the things that I feel is necessary to get me to learn vocabulary and kanji. I don't think people who use tools and think that they're defined by tools can see eye to eye with me. They want a tool to do those things for them because they don't want to do those things. I look for tools to inspire me to do more with what they offer. I iterate on the tools. I want to build more things off the tools. I want to be inspired and use whatever they teach me and adjust it to other things. So Duo definitely taught me some interesting approaches that I haven't done in a long while, like connecting Hanzi. For example, one of the consequences, connecting Hanzi with kanji. That's not my idea. Or using sound meaning and writing again, like presentation to connect characters. I didn't do that in a long time. It's been so long since I've done that. Actually, English doesn't quite rely on most of these, actually. Like the way they're associating it. So in the future, I'm going to see, and I kid you not, this is down the path after Spanish. What's after Spanish? Actually, it's going to be Hanzi first, because I'm going to finish the Chinese course first. So I'm going to use the Chinese English course to practice Chinese while figuring out how Chinese people are learning English from Duolingo, because that's really fun. Like, that's a new way. I haven't thought of it that way. Like, what is it like? I'm already sort of doing it now as we're translating. However, I would love to do that. It's probably Chinese first, because we'll complete the Chinese course before the Japanese. So some of the time is going to be divided using Chinese to do the English course, the Chinese English course, the one where you set your speaking language to Chinese and then tackle their English course. I need to brush up on my English. It's terrible. It's subpar. My foundations are subpar, because being a native speaker means you don't have to practice foundations anymore. Like, you don't practice foundations. Like I just said, pedagogy, pedagogics, right? Pedagogics. That's probably not how that's spelled. Right. I don't know. Foundations. If you don't output it, you don't know the gaps. You're surprised the Chinese course is that short? It's quite short. I think the word I would use is it's very dense. The Chinese course is incredibly dense. And I almost feel like if the Japanese... more people would be interested in having the Japanese course structured like the Chinese course. It's really dense. So the ground it covers is half the time. half the time, half everything, half the repetitions. And then half the time means double the volume. So you have less prompts. You have less prompt cycling. You have less prompt changing, interchanging. You have like one prompt example of one grammar point. If you're lucky, you might have two for one grammar point. In Japanese, you have like a whole unit. That's like, for me personally, that's like 6 hours of like one point. So the question is, which one do I gather faster? I actually gather faster in Chinese. However, with that said, there's a caveat here. I do have intuition in Chinese, so I don't know how much of that plays into it. I wasn't a blank slate in Chinese. Now, the question is, does that mean that if Japanese was structured that way, I would move at the same pace that we're moving in a Chinese course? It could be possible. I'm not going to get stuck on that point. I think that point is incredibly unhealthy. When someone says, I wasted my time when I could have been learning faster. If I am always, like, from day to day, going to think of it this way, then boy, it doesn't take 30 years before you're nihilistic. In fact, I'll put the age medium at around 18 years old, the moment they have to leave the nest or be pressured to leave the nest because of like older gen values. Waste your time. Like, I don't think I ever waste my time. I try my best when I choose to do something. I try my best. There's things to learn. So every waking moment that I try my best, I'm learning something. It's only a waste of time when you choose not to learn from it. Like, for example, understanding that you can't get to your inspiration. You know, like, oh, if I started with Anki, what if I started with Anki first before I encountered Duolingo? Then I would have wasted less time. Like, you wouldn't know. In order to get to Anki for your life, you've gone through Duo. So Duo is responsible for you to understand what you needed and how it pushed you to Anki. If Duo was not there, it is just as likely that you wouldn't have discovered Anki. Like, you don't know. We're linear time creatures. Events lead to other events. So saying living in the past and trying to adjust it and saying you wasted your time because now you're more competent is, in my opinion, a logical fallacy. That is so much how the internet is, how the internet solves problems. Like, oh man, now I feel bad about this because this person got to the same point I did faster. Man, if that person make you feel like they did everything to supplant what you did, what were you doing? Like, what I mean is, if you spent 2 years learning a language, what were the other times you were doing? Like, you couldn't. So you're telling me this person spent 3 months doing exactly all the things that you've done in 2 years. You haven't learned anything additional, anything from that experience, or use any of that time in those 2 years that this person did in 3 months. That's astonishing. That is very disappointing and also incredibly concerning. If you're like 40 or 50 or 60, that is a recipe for someone who has no closure in their life. Like, they will look back and filled with regret. Like, I've legitimately have talked to someone who says they don't regret their actions, yet they spend like 50 to 60% of their time talking about how they would have done something different or changed something if they were to do it again. That is not a person that I seem to be acquainted with, someone who lives a life without regret. I'm 37. Granted, I don't need to live a life without regret. However, I think I'm there already to a lot of extent. It comes with age, in my opinion. I like to believe people have more resilience, better understanding of themselves over time. So you don't get that crazy thing. It really hurts my soul when someone says, oh, I just wasted my time. Like, how? Explain. And they said, oh, you know, I've been working on this thing and basically it didn't work, so I wasted my time. Did you learn anything from why it didn't work? Like, did you have memories of it? Because if you remembered what you did, isn't that valuable? It's like, no, you know, whatever. I'll just forget that I even have done it. It's like, wow. I'm sorry. Like, what else can I say from a healthy-minded, forward person? Like, I'm sorry to hear that you're willing to forget what you did and not take anything, right? So, am I wasting my time on Duolingo? The answer is no, I'm not. I can assure you, though, there have been plenty of attempts to gaslight me to suggest otherwise. I'm like, okay, that's fine. And, you know, if they argue like, well, most Duo users would be wasting their time. It's like, all right, cool. I mean, did you determine that by looking at me for 5 seconds? Or are you weighing statistics? Because that's fine, too. I mean, it's perfectly valid. If you somehow magically found out that 40% of Duolingo users waste their time learning Japanese because they never get fluent or conversational after completing the entire course, I would say that's a possibility. And then I would say a vast majority of people don't even get to the end of the Japanese course. I would point out a break in their logic. Actually, if you represent the solution to Duolingo's weakness in the Japanese course, wouldn't that say it is more likely that most people don't get to fluency or anything, and you can't actually surmise how useful the Japanese course is because the vast majority of the people you interact with didn't even complete the course? I'm not saying I would end up coming to the same conclusions. What I'm saying is that there's a very distinct possibility that I will not be conversational. I would not even be fluent. Absolutely. I would not sound native. However, did I waste my time? I think the vast majority of the time, the people who are in an echo chamber have convinced themselves that it's a waste of time. Because they choose to waste time. Oh, if only I knew there was a better app out there than Duolingo. You're on the internet, like, nonstop. Are you telling me this intelligent person that's standing in front of me that has found the perfect solution to Duolingo's situation now blames Duolingo for your own incompetence of you relying on a tool that doesn't work for you? Sorry, that's tough, right? I can only say that I'm glad you found, I say this most of the time, I'm glad you found what works for you. That is the most important message. You did not waste your time. I don't want to ever tell you waste your time. If things worked out as they should, as they have, you didn't waste your time. You used all that experience and it pushed you towards a solution. That's awesome. The scariest possible thing is someone who stops by and say, I've tried everything. I just don't know what I can do to be happy and make this work. That is probably the most scariest thing, I would say. Someone who has nothing to lose and nothing to gain is insane. That is chronic depression in a nutshell. Or nihilism. You know, someone who sleeps in bed and say, why even bother getting up? If Granger, we're for the ones who what pay attention the heck? Little detail. The oh my gosh. Tinker. I got served an ad. Anyways. Thank you for the question. Human being. I like going on a digression for any random question.
次の駅でおります。
次。次の駅。
次。
次。
の駅。
次の駅 kind of sounds cool. 次の駅でおります。おります。おります。
おります。
今日は涼しくないです。涼しくないです。
次に狭い道をまっすぐ進みます。
まっすぐ進みます。まっすぐ進みます。
次に
次に道を
まっすぐ
まっすぐ進みます。
進みます。
I can't. That sounds off. おまじ
次に狭い道をまっすぐ進みます。
あ、狭い道。
次に狭い道をまっすぐ進みます。
まっすぐ進み、まっすぐ進みます。Okay.
涼しい。
涼しい。
狭い。刺します。
刺します。
次。
進みません。次。次に no. 次に、oh, yeah. 次に狭い道をまっすぐ進みます。That was what that other thing was saying.
次に
次に狭い道をまっすぐ進みます。
進みます。進みません。涼しい。狭い。刺します。
刺します。次。
夜は涼しいです。
夜は涼しいです。It is cool.At night. Sochi. Are we doing, or Sochira? Where's doing Sochira? Sochira. Sochira o Masugu. Masugu. Let's go. Proceed. Susumimashou.
そちら。
そちらを。I was thinking of a different particle, but そちらを。そちらを。
まっすぐ。
進みましょう。
ましょう。う。
そちらをまっすぐ進みましょう。
Yep. That.
すみません。曲がりました。
曲がりました。
曲がり。
南はどっちですか？
南はどちらですか？
南はどっちですか？
あ！南は、oh, どっちですか？No, they got me. It's fine. That's still a valid response, but it's not what they said.
この。
この。That's a valid sentence. They're doing it intentionally to show like casual and more, a little bit more casual form. この病院、この病院は広いです。
病は
広い、
広いです。
あ、広い、
広い。
学校はど、学校はそっちです。
学校はそっちです。
曲がります、
曲がります。
次に広い道をまっすぐ進みます。次に広い道をまっすぐ進みます。
あ、次に、
次に、
あ、う、
広い道を、次に広い道をまっすぐ進みます。
まっすぐ進みます、
進ます。
どっち、いや、yes、 どっちは、あ、どっちは東ですか。あ、oh、 北ですか。
どっちは北ですか。
あ、北は、あ、yeah、 I don't know thing。
あそこの角を右に曲がります。
I guess it was worth a shot to test that。
あそこの角を右に曲がります。あそこ。
あそこ、no no 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 what？
あそこの角を右に曲がります。
あそこ
の
の角、角、
角、
あ、角、 something something。
あそこの角を右に曲がります。
右
右、
あ、右に
を、
右は右に
曲がります。
右に
前、
右
をに、
わいわいわい、
を、あそこの角を右に曲がります。前を、あそこの角を右に曲がります。を、あそこの角を右に曲がります。あそこの角を右に曲がります。お、あそこの角を右に曲がり、ま、
You can't hear the O, but I had to do, I had to check the grammar. You can't hear the O because it runs together. I kind of got help. Needed grammar for that.
広い、
曲がりました、
曲がりました。狭い、夜、
涼しい。
ここの角を左に曲がります。ここの、
の角をここの角をどこですか。
角、
あ、角を、
ここの角を左に曲がります。
左、
左
に曲がります。
曲がります。
学校はそっちです。
学校はそっちです。ヘッキン、このここ、ここの窓、あ、角、ここの角、あ、角、右の左、左に曲がります。
ここの角、
角を、
を、ひに、
左に曲がります。
曲がります。
東はあっちです。
東はあっちです。あっちです。
こっちこっち
こっちこっち。
週末はあっちこっち行きます。
週末はあっちこっち行きます。あっちこっち行きます。あっちこっち。A lot of fun.
Kitawa Achi desu.
Kitawa Achi desu. Achi desu.
Minami wa dochi desu ka?
南どちらですか？
南はどっちですか？
北は
どっちですか？
パンパン。One more lesson. 10-15 minutes. We're moving to Chinese. Good old Chinese. Chinese on review is our shortest day.Not too bad. Not too bad.
進みません。
進みません。
南はどっちですか？
南はどっちですか？
南はどっち？
どっち
ですか？
北は北はどっちですか？
どっでか？
風は涼しいですか？
風は涼しいですか？
次に狭い道をまっすぐ進みます。次に
次にまっすぐやめろパパ。
次に狭い道をまっすぐ進みます。
狭い道を
まっすぐ
進みます。
進みます。
寒くない？
寒くない。
そちらをまっすぐ進みましょう。
そちら
そちら
そちらブラブラブラ。
そちらをまっすぐ進みましょう。
そちらをまっすぐ
まっすぐ
まっすぐ進みましょう。
進みましょう。
今日は暖かく明日は涼しいです。
今日は暖かく暖かく今日はNo. 明日は涼しいです。今日は暖かく。暖かく。明日は涼しいです。次に No, に、Yes, に、次に狭い道をまっすぐ進みます。
次に
狭い道
をまっすぐ
進みます。
進みます。
今日は寒い日ですね。
今日は寒い日ですね。Oh,
they accepted that. Interesting. Interesting. Okay.
そちらを
まっすぐ。
まっすぐ。まっすぐ。
進む。まう。
進みましょう。あ、夜は涼しいです。
夜は涼しいです。
はい。15 minutes and a dream. Okay. 涼しい。
うん。涼しい。
涼しい。
涼しい。
涼しい。涼しい。
涼しい。
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 涼しい。涼しい。
橋。
暑い。
暑い。ああ、yeah, fair enough. Fair enough.
暑い。
Well.
橋。
お箸。
暑い。
暑い。That's how I remember 暑い, actually.
暑い。
Because the most recent vocabulary was 橋。
暑い。
Or, 京都。Kyoto works too. 暑い。
甘い。
甘い。
お箸。お金。
お茶。
暑い。
お箸。
お箸。
お箸。お箸。
お箸、
お
箸、
お金、
お腹、
お腹、
I pointed to my stomach.
熱い、 熱い、強い、
お箸、
お箸、
多い、
多い、
熱い、
熱い、
お酒、
お酒、
お箸、
お箸、
ご飯、熱い、
熱い、
暖
かい、暖かい、
暖かい、
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 oh, I don't know if you're here, still here, human. Did your friend end up taking up learning Japanese? It's always nice to have a friend that's going through the journey too.
暖かい、
oof. Hey, I don't have anyone who's interested in doing this.
暖かい、
I personally, in like a, in that type of way.Nah, they said they were too lazy to do it. Aww. Like, it's so, when you have a friend to learn it, it only makes me, like, want to join them. Like, I would slow down everything. I would, like, go along with them, like, catch them up or something, or, like, wait on them. Or, like, slow my pace and have time, like, retroactively teaching or, like, hanging around and stuff. That's you're just waiting for a couple minutes so I can review some more kanji. Ah, nice. You're putting a little space on it. Very nice. That is highly recommended.
Atsui.
Actually, my rants, like my digressions, are how I'm spacing it. Yeah, self SRS, exactly. I actually use a rants. So, like, I say a lot of times when people say, oh yeah, you've been using Duolingo for 6 hours, it's like, it's more like I've used Duolingo for like 1 hour, and it's like spaced out with like 30 minutes or 2 hours or 3 hour digressions. So, but I do feel very refreshed as I'm going. Yeah, self SRS it's great giving moments of being able to push how far or how long it's been. Last one, it's a very important concept for sure. Very requires a lot of discipline as well, because if you push it off, you know, some people might push it off completely. that's a shame that your friend couldn't join you. I think having a friend who's starting a journey is like extra energy. Super extra energy.
Atsui.
Whenever someone wants to learn something and they say like they're worried about it, my very first thing is I would say, let's do it together. So someone earlier today asked me, oh, have I done coding before? Because I seem to participate in a lot of things. And yeah, the last time I actually messed around with C or C++ was because some other person, someone I know, needed to learn enough C++ and C to like do things, and that's when I learned a bit of it, quite a bit of it on my own.
Same.
You do have another friend who started Japanese before you did, but they quit a few weeks in. Oh, that's unfortunate. Like, unfortunate in the sense of from your perspective, as in you could have had like a really wonderful
semi,
like studying back and forth between someone you personally know.
Semi.
Not necessarily like you need it or anything like that.
Semi.
And then, you know, they're moving on to whatever is more important to them, hopefully.
Semi.
And it doesn't like leave a negative impression on them.
Semai. Semai.
If my parents' enthusiasm was any of a demotivator, my parents like, oh, Japanese. Okay. And then I mentioned I was also working on Mandarin. And this is like really recent, and then they said my father's first comment was he thought I said Cantonese instead, because Puntunghua and Guntunghua are very close. And my I was like, no, I'm studying Mandarin. His first comment was like, no, you need to study a language that has more pragmatic impact, right? And that's Chinese parents for you. Like, immediately it's like, oh, Japanese, okay, that's cute, kind of thing.
Kasa.
That's how you test your will and your motivation.
Kasa. Kasa.
It's a testament Kasa. To how Japan Kasa. Has so many influences in specific spheres, yet
Kasa.
Its influence Kasa. In language is not quite prevalent. And Kasa. I think we'll have another talk in 5 or 10 years. I think the landscape is going to be very different for Japanese.
Kasa.
Like, due to its trends in online, I think the perception of what's acceptable and what's being forwarded will reach like a normalization to make it a lot more influential.
Suzushii.
We have to keep in mind the whole like casual and hardcore and acceptable thing. Hardcore, more stringent, means less appeal and less potential influence, right? Of course, there's a give or take, like a compromise. I don't think Japanese learning has reached that like nice like a steady state yet of growth. Doesn't stop me from trying to learn Japanese though.
Suzushii.
Suzushii.
There are very notable content creators that are
Suzushii.
Obviously trying
Suzushii.
To make Suzushii. It more engaging and more approachable.
Suzushii.
涼しい
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 Oops.
せまい。
狭い
狭い
Yeah
狭い、
Case in point, right? The whole Inktober thing
狭い
was not my idea
狭い
It was on the spur of the moment
狭い
Someone was doing it and I'm like, what is it that you're doing?
狭い
Like, oh, I always, you know, that sounds neat
狭い
And the rest is history Right, fourth year in a row
狭い
That person stopped, like, that year. That person stopped after doing, like, 9 prompts. That same year that I started in 2021. I was gonna try, like, motivate him, whatnot. So we were going back and forth and kept talking about things. The person kept falling behind over and over again.
広い
And then the following year, like
広い
Then
広い
広い
That person was the artist, not me
広い
広い
At the time
広い
広い
Obviously, they had more important things. That's largely
広い
What I say
広い
They had more important things.There we go. Kado. Kado.
Kado.
Kado.
Kado.
Kado.
Kado.
Kado.
Kado.
Starting Japanese was the... This is probably the longest project that I voluntarily done Kado. Out of self-interest.
Kado.
So it's safe to say, because of self-interest, I'm not dependent on anyone else's motivations. Largely, though, I prefer to be motivated by others.
Kado.
I'm not very in it for myself these days. It's not necessary when there are so many other things you can do with other people. Encourage them to do things. I feel my time is...incredibly significant if I can get people to do things. So, since I'm doing something of selfish interest, I might as well share it, right?
Sugi.
And hope that, some indirect Sugi. Way I can motivate other
Sugi.
People.
Sugi.
Give back. Give back for all the other people Sugi. Who inspired me Sugi. To do more.
Sugi.
Sugi.
Solving problems.Problems of motivation, problems of life, satisfaction, problems of closure. So many things. And then when they're happy, they go on and do their thing. And I might, if I get lucky, I might be able to see it.
Hiroi.
Witness all the magical things that they
Hiroi.
Are able to accomplish
Hiroi. Hiroi.
With a healthy, Hiroi. Positive mindset.
Hiroi.
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 It's devastating to see someone who is comfortable in their own misery.
Kado.
Not, and I'm not saying it's as extreme. There are individuals who compromise so much for things that they voluntarily do. That they have this like relationship where they love to get up to do something they dislike. Like voluntarily.We're not talking about a job here.
Kado.
I rarely have friends around me that would say like,
Kado.
I don't want to do this, and yet I'm doing Kado. It. Kind of thing. Like, oh, I love this hobby, and then proceeds Kado. To spend like,
Kado.
The majority of their time complaining about what they don't like Kado. About the hobby, right? I understand that's kind of Kado. A way...to cope and
Kado.
normalize continuing to do a hobby. Even like living in one's country, that happens a lot. It's like, oh yeah, I hate this country for all it can't do for me. While saying, oh, have you forgotten what it can do for you? Kind of thing. Or what is it doing? That kind of thing. Gotta need that balance. If you're negative about yourself, then I'm here to balance out that negativity. Or at least we'll try to balance out that negativity. Although the opposite is also true. A lot of times when someone is over promising and over like incredibly prideful and potentially out of touch, probably bring them down to earth a little bit. If there was trust and respect already. Most of the time those people have have already made up their minds. So in that situation it doesn't hurt as much. It's usually the other way around. Alright, that's the end of 15 minutes. It's usually when someone's at rock bottom, right? Rock bottom. I run towards people who are at rock bottom or maybe like in a declining spiral, because in my opinion, while it sounds like it's impossible, there's so much you can do when someone is so low. So many things you can try to do. Obviously, a lot of them are going to be, the things you do are going to be not successful per se, depending on how deep in doo-doo the person is. However, it's where the healing begins, you know. It's where the transformation begins a lot of time. All right. That's a pretty good wholesome message, right? When you see someone down, maybe a little too down, and you have some free time, believe me, you and me, there's a lot to learn when trying to help someone else with a problem that you may not have ever. Or yet, I think most of the time when I solve or troubleshoot other people's like technical problems and whatnot is largely because I observed problems happening. And from that, I see people learning how to solve those problems. It's different from seeing how it's done right all the time. In fact, it's kind of trendy right now. I'm not gonna lie. It's kind of trendy right now. Here's how to do everything wrong. Here's what all the things that can go wrong or less ideal and what you can do about it series. Lots of the like the food people, especially the food people, the bigger like long format food people are going about it that way. We're like, oh, hey. And I really applaud that. It's very not as popular, but it's nice to see that very large content creators are focusing on that now where, oh, here's six different things that can potentially hit a snag while you're going to do this. And what you want to, like, alternatives that you can do to maybe rescue it. Especially in food right now. However, I would love to see that for other things. Like, what happens when you do feel like you're wasting your time? What can we do about it? Here are seven different experts that all encounter these problems, and here are their perspective on how they go about it. Choose what seems good for you, that kind of thing, right? That's lovely. I like to echo that if you're not the person who intuits problem solving as a necessity for learning, having content creators that make it entertaining and necessitate, you know, exposed to that, it's great. It'll lead into a generation of intuitive critical thinkers, possibly. Unless we usher in a generation of people who just remember the solutions, which it can't happen. Like, for example, you have students like this a lot of times. what happens if you have no power delivery to your PC? And then they would look up, you know, what could go wrong, and then it would be like the top three. And it's like, well, I tried all the top three reasons and it doesn't work. It's like, did you learn anything from trying the top three? What else could it be? Like, well, no one has a post that specifically answers my question, so I don't know. That could happen. It is possible, because again, when someone is producing the results and creating the results, it goes a great way to offer inspiration input. However, it does remove the necessity for the output. You yourself are not solving those problems. You yourself may have a context that is slightly unique, and the older you get, the problems you have will become more and more unique. And growing older, in my opinion, is a process of accumulating experiences that, for better or for worse, when you watch a YouTube video on how to, when you watch it, you'll modify it immediately because of your experience, right? It's like, oh, let's see. And you know, I don't have that exact tool, but I do have something that's similar, and I think I can make it work. That, in my opinion, is the resourcefulness that goes into learning all the time. Like, it transcends language learning. However, language learning could teach you that about your mental state, right? How often, how long do you take a break before reviewing a, you know, SRS? If an SRS is doing it for you, it can either work or it doesn't work, right? And if it works, what makes it work? Did you write that down? Then you won't need to go to another language and do the same SRS. You could do it yourself if you want it. Or you can rely on it. And what happens when you have like Duolingo, where, oh, you wanted to learn this language, but only the Spanish version has all these things? Learn the Spanish version because you're already learning Spanish. Adapt whatever is available and take it to the other language. I took whatever is available in Japanese and applied it to the Chinese course, because the Chinese course is organized differently. Whatever I did with the Chinese course, I'm adapting it to the Japanese course, if I can, right? I'm trying to learn from the process. Not all the time will meet the ideal cases. When you watch a YouTube video, how to cook X, Y, and Z, it might not meet all the occasions, right? The idea is, you don't necessarily have to do it exactly the same. And I hope that in the future, more people are convinced not to do it exactly the same and not be compared in that way, because innovation happens then. And I mean earnestly true innovation, not iteration or repackaging of something as subterfuge for something new, right? Oh, here's how to do a life hack, because, and then it ultimately creates more work. Like that's different. Spinning the wheel in place, or adding more problems to the wheel, that's a little different than critical thinking would present. Obviously, not all innovations or trials would lead to great leaps of improvement. However, it's one of those things where you can synthesize information and head nudge towards a different direction. And that's the take-home message, right, for today. Really cool. I love talking about learning, especially how to keep consistent and do these, you know. I don't grow tired of this. Like, I think Duolingo is a backdrop that it's fine. If someone from Tofuku comes to me with a sponsorship for WaniKani, I'm game. If they say, hey, we want you to stream WaniKani because we're starting a Twitch thing, I'm game. I don't think I need to rely on any specific tool. Duolingo just happens to be very coincidentally poised to be convenient. I would totally take that sponsorship because it's convenient. It lines up with my opportunities. Hey, maybe shout outs to Satori Reader or something. Give me a 1 month, no no liability, copyright free, you know, demo or something. I'd do it for a month. Absolutely. Hands down. But for now, it's Duolingo. For better or for worse for some people. And for me, it's a good backdrop. Talk about learning all the time. Like, if Duolingo doesn't do X, Y, and Z, what can you do with the things Duolingo offers? Much like my YouTube channel says, human creativity is a feedback loop. You take human creativity, which includes products, right? Products like apps and whatnot. You take that creativity, you feed on it, you iterate on it, or like you improve it, inspires creativity, then you send it along its way. Oh, there, EDU Kazuma. Interesting name. All right, so that's the end of our Japanese session. So if you're gonna watch this later, arigato gozaimasu, right? Until next time, for all the Japanese language learners out there, right? Mata ne. Ja ne, minasan. I'm gonna switch to Chinese now. I'm gonna take a quick break, a bathroom break, and I'll be back for my Chinese life. So, thank you.